Hello everybody, I hope you're all well and getting ready for Pesach. Baruch Hashem, I was able to steal away a little bit of time today. It's Sunday morning, tonight, Leil B'dikas Chametz, and I really wanted to try to get across as fast as I can, as much as I can, like a crash course in Hilchos Pesach, going through as much as I can of the halachos of tonight, of the B'dikas Chametz, Bir Chametz, and then actually getting into, if we have time, to get into the halachos of getting ready for the Seder and the halachos of the Seder itself. Some stuff like this. I just have, you know, a bunch of papers here that I'll go through with you, just bullet points that I have. Okay, I'm just going to get started. I wanted to start with one hashkafic idea, one inyan. We're about to start the halachos of getting rid of chametz and destroying all the chametz, and I'm sure we've all heard the idea that the chametz is also a metaphor for our yetzahara, a metaphor for foreign influences, for negative influences in our lives. And so I just saw a very interesting idea this year. You know, the Gemara says an interesting thing. You know, we do all this stuff. We go crazy to get rid of our chametz, and we clean everything, and we switch our dishes, and we do all of these things. Yeah, we're going to see soon exactly the halachos of that. But the Gemara says a very interesting thing, which is a, you know, somewhat cryptic line. The Gemara says, you know, mid'oraisa bitul ma'al masagi. That on a Torah level, if a person just nullifies their chametz, if they just say, I'm hereby nullifying and making all of my chametz hefker, which we do, which we're going to talk about in a second, yeah, that on a Torah level is enough. But really, why would you have to go around and clean and look for everything is because we can't eat chametz on Pesach. So if we're just going to go ahead and nullify it in our mind, we may end up eating it, which we'll discuss in a second. You see something very interesting. You see that on some level, like the ikur bittul of chametz is something that takes place in your das. Something that takes place in your intellect, in your mind. And on a certain level, you know, yes, there's a physical expression, you know, like everything. With every mitzvah, there's always a physical outward expression, so we have to physically go through our house and get rid of all the chametz and change our dishes over and make sure we're not eating it and everything like that. You just see an interesting thing, and it's even reflected in the halacha, that the ikur, the main separation between us and chametz has to happen in our mind. And what does that mean? It means separating from the yetzahara, separating from the influences, you know, those influences that puff us up, those influences that are machmitz us. Okay, there's a lot to talk about that, but I want to go into the halachos now, but I just thought I would start with that, just an interesting idea. Okay, so I just want to talk about quickly, you know, Pesach cleaning. By this point, you know, everybody basically, hopefully, is cleaned for Pesach, so it doesn't pay to get so much into those that topic. But the truth of the matter is that there really is no halach of Pesach cleaning. The whole idea of Pesach cleaning is really just getting ready for the bedikah, getting ready for the mitzvahs that are going to take place this evening. So I just want to speak about what those mitzvahs are, you know, what the different aspects are and what we're doing, and then just to practically to go through some of the halachos about what to do for B'dikas Chametz. So the halacha is basically like this, you know, the Psukim say, these are all in Parshas Bo, B'Shalach, Shmos, Perek Yud Gimel, V'lo Yera L'cha Chametz, V'lo Yera L'cha So'or B'chol V'lecha. You can't see on Pesach time, you can't see any chametz, you can't have any leaven in your homes. Ach b'yom harishon tashbisu so'or mebateichem, you have to destroy all the chametz from your house. Kol ha'ochel chametz v'nichnas ha'nefesh ha'himi Yisrael, if anybody eats chametz, they'll be cut off. Shivas yomim so'or lo yimati v'bateichem, you can't find chametz in your house, you know, the whole time of Pesach. So we see here mentioned explicitly in the Psukim two things. You know, there's one thing is that there's an isser to own any chametz, and there's another mitzvah that we have to destroy the chametz. You can't own, you can't eat. I'm sorry, those two isurim. You can't own chametz, you can't eat chametz. And there's a mitzvah to destroy the chametz. So what we're doing is like this. The whole Pesach cleaning that we're doing and the mitzvah bedika that we're going to do is all to make sure that the chametz is out of our property, out of our house, so that we don't violate one of these two isurim, that we don't by accident eat chametz on Pesach. You know, if we were just nullify the chametz in our mind, but we would still have our Cheerios in the cabinet. So this morning our house is already Pesachdik, and you know, the little baby is downstairs, and he's saying, you know, Cheerios, Cheerios. Now we have to explain the whole thing, no Cheerios, right? If you have it around, it'll easily end up being eaten. So you have to get rid of it for that reason. And number two, you have to make sure that you're not owning anything, that you're not over Bal Yirah. So you have to do search your house and get rid of all the chametz. Now, in addition, we have this mitzvah of biur chametz, a mitzvah to destroy any chametz that a person has, and that's a mitzvah that we're going to be makayim erev Pesach in the morning. You know, this year it'll be Monday morning. Okay, so let's just talk now. First thing about the bdika. What is the story? So again, the idea is that there's a mitzvah Chazal set up to do specifically orla ba'asar, the evening of the 14th, meaning the night, Sunday night, the night before the Leil Seder, to do it at nighttime with a light source, either a candle or a flashlight, and to search one's home for chametz. Now, the point of the bedika at this point, again, once a house has already been cleaned, so the point of the bedika is as follows. It's a mitzvah. It's a mitzvah that we're required to do. We make a bracha on it. And what we're going to do is going to look through the whole house and make sure that there's no chametz sitting out. Again, at this point, we're not looking for crumbs. Crumbs are really batel on their own. The clean floors have been cleaned and these types of things. But we're going to go through a list of the different places in the house a person has to go through in order to make sure that there's no actual chametz there, because sometimes, people forget things and they think that we're looking for crumbs and this, but sometimes, there could be a box of Cheerios in the trunk of the car that a person didn't realize. So in terms of the kitchen, again, at this point, the kitchen is probably turned over already, and all your chametz stick dishes are taken away, but the bedikah is a time to go through any area of the kitchen that you're going to be using. You have to look over there and make sure. That includes the refrigerator and the freezer. I'll never forget, one of my rebbeim told us a story that on Pesach, they found in his freezer, the back of the freezer, wrapped up in tinfoil, or plastic wrap or something, a challah dough that had been there from before Yontif. They just didn't think to look in the freezer. Yeah, you have to look in your fridge, look in your freezer, and make sure that there's anything, any area that's going to be open for Pesach. Now, areas that you're closing off, let's say you have an area of your refrigerator or a whole refrigerator or a cabinet or a closet that you're closing off for Pesach and you're selling, meaning you're including that in the contract that your husband or that you or your father is going to be selling to the rabbi, so then that area you don't need to do a bedikah. Any area that you're sealing off and closing off for Pesach, you don't need to do a bedikah. And therefore you don't need to clean out either. But we're talking here about the areas that you're going to be using on Pesach, the areas of the kitchen. When it comes to the living room and the dining room, again, you have to go through any of those areas. If your cabinets, you've got cabinets or you've got chametz stick dishes and a break front or something like that, you have to make sure that it's closed off and that those dishes are closed off for Pesach. You don't need to actually sell the dishes. No halacha, you need to sell those dishes. They're not actually included in the sale, but the halacha is you should hang up like paper or something in front of the cabinets that you can't see them. You're not supposed to see them, and it's supposed to be sealed off so you can't have access to them. Same thing in your bedrooms. You're not looking necessarily for, crumbs and chunks of food. Hopefully you're not, eating sandwiches in your bedroom. Well, I guess maybe people do. Yeah, but you're looking for, there may be products in your room. You maybe have, food, wrapped up in a suitcase or in a briefcase or something. You have to look in your nightstands. You have to look in all those areas in your room where, you may have put food over the course of the year. In addition, same thing with clothing. All clothing has to be gone through that you're going to be wearing over Pesach. Again, if you've got clothing that you don't want to wear, you want to put it away in an area that's going to be sealed off that you're not going to use over Pesach, so that's fine, and then you don't have to go through it. But otherwise, you have to go through all of your pockets, right? All of the, if you have the three or four different coats, you have to go through all of your coat pockets in order to make sure that there's no chametz that's, left in your coat pockets from, sometimes you are wearing it and you put a candy into your pocket. So again, even if you're not planning on wearing it on Pesach, if it's going to be out in your closet, you have to do a bedikah. If you don't want to have to do a bedikah on all your clothing, then you should cordon off that area in your closet, hang a sheet over it, and sell that area, but then you can't access that clothing over Pesach. Just take out what you're going to use, and the rest of it you can put away. For those of you with children, toys, you have to be very careful in terms of cleaning. Toys come to the table a lot, they get played with on the floor, kids eat while they play. You have to be very careful. I don't know, we have at home a mesh bag, and we put all the Lego into it, and you put it in the bathtub with soap, and we shake it all around, and these types of things. But you really have to be very careful with toys, and toys that are not being cleaned. Or if you have too many toys to clean, you really have to seal off some of the toys for Pesach. But you really are not supposed to have, especially toys, it's for sure very likely that there's chametz stuck in them, and it's very easy for the kids or people to end up eating it on Pesach. And it's chasram, when I have that type of situation. The same thing with books. Books that are brought to the table, the halacha is that you have to be very careful. Again, not because there's a problem to own the crumbs that are in those books. There's no issue to own crumbs on your property unless it comes to an amount of a kezias in one place. But if you've got crumbs in a book and you bring that book to the table and then you're opening the table and reading from it, then those crumbs can fall into your soup or into your plate or on your whatever, and a person can end up eating it, and that's an issue deraisa then, even if it's just crumbs. So, my general practice is svarim that I bring to the table, that regular svarim that I read at the Shabbos table, halacha svarim, these types of things. So I will not bring them to the table over Pesach. I have a small table on the side, a stender on the side where I'll put the svarim. And something also, you have to be careful in terms of children's books and these types of things. If those books are the books that come to the table during the year, you're not allowed to bring them to the table on Pesach. If you want to, then you have to really open a book and go through it very carefully, page by page, and make sure that there's no crumbs there. But it's really kedai not to do that unless it takes a long time to do that. Anyway, that's basically what we're doing. You have to also make sure you have to look in your car. In your car, you have to make sure you look in all the areas, in the glove compartment, in the little section next to, you know, the driver's seat, and in the little pockets on the side, all these places. In a trunk of a car, like I said, there are people who one time found on Pesach, you know, a whole box of cereal in the trunk of the car. You know, one time they were taking out the groceries, and it just kind of slid in the back, and it slid behind some things, and it just ended up there, and they found it on Sham Pesach. Same thing if you've got a suitcase, if you're traveling with a suitcase on Pesach. If you're not traveling again, you can just put away the suitcase and close off that area, and you don't need to clean it, you don't need to check it, and you can just put it away. But if you are keeping suitcases out, you have to make sure to go through them before Pesach. Suitcases also are places where people put food and candy and, you know, who knows what for traveling, and you know, that has to be gone through and made sure that you're not owning that on Pesach, that you're not going to come across it at all on Pesach. Okay, same thing if you have an office, you have to do a bedika in your office, unless you're locking it away for Pesach. I'm here in my office in school, but we'll be locking up over here, and you know, that'll be that for the rest of Pesach. But any other property that you have to check, and you know, make sure that you're doing the bedika there, unless you are selling it. Okay, following the bedika, once a person goes around the whole house and they've checked, you know, the minhag is that we have is to put out 10 pieces of bread. We put out 10 little pieces in different places, and we do that in order to make it be that the bracha that we're making is actually on something. You know, so we make the bracha, we go out, we search. The halacha of the person preferably should not speak during the time of the search, unless it's something related to the bedika samayitz. But you know, you shouldn't just be answering your phone and you know, stuff like that. You're supposed to be focused on on doing the bedika until you're finished. After a person goes through the house and finds those 10 pieces, so then everybody in the household should get together and you say a nusach that you find in the siddur. And basically, what it says is any chametz or leaven in the house that I don't know about, I'm hereby nullifying and making void and making completely ownerless. We say it in Aramaic, it's kol chamira v'chamia de'ikibreshusei, de'lo yadate, or de'lo chazisei, anything that I have in my possession that I didn't see or I don't know about, it should become batal. But it's very important that you say it in English if you don't know what you're saying in Aramaic, which most people don't. At home, I read it in English to make sure that everybody understands what we're saying. And what you're saying there at that point, that's not the final bittul, that's not the final time that you're nullifying all of your chametz, because what you're saying over there is only the chametz that I don't know about am I getting rid of. Why are we saying that? Because there's some chametz that you do know about. What's that? That's the 10 pieces of bread that you just collected from the bedikas chametz, and then maybe you have other chametz that you're going to still eat, a roll for breakfast the next morning, Erev Yom this morning, you're allowed to still eat chametz, or you have some cereal. And not only that, there's a mitzvah we're going to see soon, there's a mitzvah to burn the chametz on Erev Yom this morning, and you don't want to nullify the chametz that you're going to be burning, because then you're not burning your own chametz. So now we're being very careful the way that we're saying this the first time round at night, and after the bedika, we're only saying the chametz that I don't know about, and maybe if during my search, I didn't find the Cheerio here or there. I didn't find a bagel that fell under the couch or behind the oven, whatever it is. I don't know about it. So now I want to nullify that. But the chametz that I do know about, I still want to be in my possession. First of all, I'm going to be eating it maybe tomorrow morning. And second of all, I need to do the mitzvah of Teshpisa. Okay, anyway, after that point, after the bedika, so then there's no more mitzvahs to do at night. The next mitzvah comes the next morning. The mitzvah of biur chametz, the mitzvah min haTorah now, tashbisu, the mitzvah of bedikah again is only midrabanan. And min haTorah, if a person just is mevatel the chametz in their mind, that's enough. But midrabanan, the Chazal said, no, we have to go ahead and search the whole house to make sure that we don't end up having something by accident. And again, on that bracha, on that mitzvah, we make a bracha. But the bracha we make is al biur chametz. But we make it before the bedika at night, but it really goes for the bedika and then for the biur for the next morning. Now the next morning, so depending on where you live, there's a certain time by which you have to finish eating chametz, 3 hours into the day, somewhere between the 9-10 o'clock range, and then there's a certain time by which you have to stop having any benefit from any chametz, which means you're not allowed to have any ownership of chametz anymore, and that's, in the 10-11 o'clock range. You have to, check your luach in your local area where you are, but the idea is that you have to just make sure, you have to make sure in the morning that you're finished eating the chametz and that you've destroyed the chametz in the appropriate time, before the eating time and destroying before the time of you can't be benefiting from the chametz anymore. At the biur chametz, it's a nice thing to do with the whole family together. If we try to arrange that, over here in Yerushalayim, of course, on every street corner, there's 9-year-old kids tending to these massive fires. So we go over there. You're supposed to have a kazayis of chametz at least per adult, which means, you as an adult person, or any adult members of the household, each person should preferably have a kazayis of chametz that belongs to them. And the mitzvah is to throw it into the fire, And it's mamash a mitzvah deraisa. Again, we're doing the physical act, like everything in the mitzvahs, we're doing a physical act, but it's really representative of us destroying the yitzhahara from inside of us. We're getting ready for Pesach, a time where we're b'nei malachim, a time where we're b'nei chorim, you know, a time that we're really operating on a higher spiritual level, and there's no place for chametz in our lives at that point. You know, the Zohar writes, it's like you know, a person who needs a certain medicine, he doesn't need it all the time. He needs that medicine for a particular time during the year so that the rest of the year he can act in a normal way. So we're only allowed to have chametz the rest of the year because during this time of Pesach, we keep ourselves on a very high spiritual diet physically. But again, that physical manifestation is really manifesting something, you know, a metaphor for something much, much deeper that's happening in time in terms of our ruchnias. And that's why, again, you know, we're being mevatel the chametz, the yitzhahara from our mind, also from our das. That's, you know, the main thing. Anyway, at the viewer, when we throw our chametz into the fire, at that point we say you want to be very careful about this. The poskim say a person should make sure that they wait until after the chametz is properly burned. The Shulchan Aruch writes that the mitzvah is to burn the chametz until it's crisp, until it's, you know, totally crisp. So get this one, like a, you know, chumrah here. So if you do the bittul while the chametz is still on fire, so then you're like being mevatel the chametz before it was completely destroyed. So they say you should wait a minute or two before you do the bittul. Okay, that's something, if you have the time, you can do that. You know, it's nice for the kids anyway sometimes to watch the stuff burn. You know, if you're really daring, you let the kids get involved with the sticks and what have you. Anyway, you should wait and then you know, do the bittul. And at this point, if you'll pay attention to the nusach, we say all chametz I know about, whether I know about it, I don't know about, whether I found it, whether I didn't find it, you know, any chametz that I have, I am hereby being mevatel, and I would like to get rid of it. Hold on, just 1 second. So I am getting rid of all the chametz, and at that point, I'm completely chametz free. At that point, my house should be completely ready for Pesach, and you know, no more chametz around anywhere. And I did all the mitzvahs having to do this. Okay, I just want to speak for a second about the product. You know, a bunch of people have asked me questions about this. First of all, if anybody wants to WhatsApp me, it's working out great in terms of answering questions and you know, halacha shaylas. And even if you've emailed me something and I haven't responded to you, sorry. First of all, I apologize. Second of all, please WhatsApp me if you can. It goes by my Israeli phone number, 052-677-4140. Okay. Anyway. So I just want to read this to you. This is the policy on medicines, cosmetics, and toiletries for the CRC. This is, you know, always what I go by and what I, you know, tell students. So this, you know, you can find this online if you just search for CRC, medications, Pesach, anything along those lines. It's from the Chicago Rabbinical Council, but it's signed by, you know, Rabbi Shmuel First, also, and Rabbi David Zucker, you know, two poskim in Chicago that I'm very close with, in addition to the Rabbanim from the CRC. And it basically says over like this, all pill medication with or without chametz that one swallows is permitted without special hashgacha. Any pills that are medicine, not talking about vitamins, but any pill medication, whether it's for headaches, whether it's for, you know, any illness is mutter. All chewable pills that have kidneys are permitted. Okay, this is if it's on a list that it only has kidneys, but it's chewable, it's permitted. If there's chametz and there's nothing else available, you have to ask a rav. Any liquid medications really should you should really ask a rav. Unless you know for sure it's only kidneys or chametz free. When it comes to cosmetics and toiletries, all soaps, shampoos, and stick deodorants are permitted regardless of their ingredients. That means even if your shampoo says wheat germ and who knows what, mango, you know, nectar, shampoo, it's mutter. Yeah, any soaps, body soaps, any types of ointments, creams, nail polish, hand lotions, eyeshadow, eyeliner, mascara, blush, foot and face powders, and ink and paint may be used regardless of their ingredients. Okay, I'm not going to read through that list again. You can just go back. Yeah, colognes, perfumes, hairspray, shaving lotions, and deodorants that have restorable denatured alcohol should not be used. Okay, so anything like this, any of these liquid things, colognes and perfumes and hairspray and shaving lotions, these things are deodorants that are liquid, then you have to look on the directions already and see if it's on one of those lists. I'm not going to go through the whole thing here. And the lipstick, if it's chametz stick lipstick, you shouldn't use it. And they also say you should not use the same lipstick that you use during the year or wipe off the top, but I'm told women don't like to do that. It doesn't work, so just get yourself another lipstick. Good job, Tiff. Okay. That's when it comes to the bdika. That's when it comes to getting the chametz from your house. Let's talk about the seder for a little bit. I just want to go through the halachos of the seder. We'll go in order of the seder, but a lot of these things I'll just mention in terms of getting ready from Erev Shabbos. what to do to get ready. First of all, the halacha is that before the men come home from shul, it should be like this every Shabbos, particularly when it comes to the Leil Seder, this is supposed to be a festive night, a happy night. The poskim say you're supposed to do your best to rest during the day if you can, really to try to plan things and schedule things and get help from your family in such a way that you're able to take it easy a little bit on the Pesach afternoon, because the mitzvahs of the night, all women have to do. And sometimes women get into Pesach and they're so tired and so burned out that they don't really feel like doing anything more, and they miss parts of the Seder, which is really missing everything. So the halacha is really a person should try to take a rest Erev Yantif if it's going to help you, get ready for the Seder. Okay. So the table should be set, everything should be ready, where B'nai Chorin, a person should set the table with the finest things that they have. It's supposed to be a night where we act like kings. Men wear a kittel, the all-white kittel that men wear. Usually men only start wearing it after the Shana Rishona. Most people have the minhag during Shana Rishona. They don't wear the kittel. Men during the year in Avelus also, I believe that many of the men have not to wear the kittel. But otherwise, we wear a kittel because with all these festivities, we're supposed to just make sure that we remember that we don't get too carried away with being happy, and remember that one day I'm going to be buried in this garment. Okay, so we start with Kadesh. Kadesh is we make Kiddush on the Yom Tov night, and there's a few mitzvahs that are going on over here. Number one, there's a mitzvah d'oraisa every time on Yom Tov and Shabbos to make Kiddush. That's number one. There's one mitzvah, nothing to do with the rest of the halachos of the Seder. It's just the mitzvah of Kiddush on Yom Tov night, and we're going to make a Shechianu that we're making then, unless you made it already by candlelighting. But the Shechianu that we make is on Yom Tov itself and on all the mitzvahs of the night that we're going to be doing. Okay, in addition, now because it's Pesach, so we have a separate mitzvah of Dalet Kosos. On the Pesach night for the Seder, we have four cups of wine that have to be drunk, or grape juice that have to be drunk on a particular Seder, on a particular order, and Kiddush is the first of those four cups. Now the halachos of these Dalet Kosos are different than the regular halachos of Kiddush on Shabbos night. And these Dalet Kosos, for all of them, the halacha is that everybody has to have their own cup, whereas normally on Kiddush on Shabbos night, it's okay if one person makes Kiddush and you're just listening, Shomei Ka'one, you're listening to the person make the bracha and you're being yotzei, because it's as if you're saying it when you're focused in on them. Yeah, but it's okay if they drink, you don't need to drink. But here on Pesach night, everybody, women included, has to drink four cups of grape juice or wine. The halacha is that the poskim say b'zmanenu that grape juice works. A person can use grape juice if they prefer it, otherwise if you use wine, then use a light wine so a person doesn't get drunk. You have to have a revius in the cup. Revius, the poskim say, it should be about a 4.5 ounce cup minimum. You shouldn't use a small cup. If it's a very small cup, if it's less than 3 1/3 ounces, then for sure it's no good. But ideally, it should be about 4.4 ounces, just under 4.5 ounces. And the halacha is that each time we drink one of the cups, each one of the four of them, when we drink, we have to drink rov of the cup, most of the cup. When it comes to leaning, the halacha is that the men for sure have to lean. The halacha is for men to lean. When it comes to women, there's different minhagim. Some women have the minhag to lean, some women don't. You should follow your, excuse me, whatever your minhag is, when it comes to that. But again, the first cup is Kiddush. Everybody holds the cup in their hand. Either everybody says the bracha out loud, or again, we listen to the one person, the head of the household, who's going to make Kiddush and say it there. But it's really as if you're saying it. It's not them saying it. By them saying it, you're listening and tuning in and saying it together with them. Okay, that's Kaddish. The next thing up we have is Urchatz. Here we wash our hands the first time without a bracha, Val Netilas Yadayim. We do this washing to get ready for the karpas that we're going to have. Karpas is when we take something out to Adama and we dip it into salt water to commemorate the tears of Bnei Yisrael. People use all different things for karpas. We use celery at home. Some people use potatoes. I know in my community, the Rabbi Taitzach on Rav used to use bananas. Anything that's Adama. But the halacha is you're supposed to eat less than a kezayis of it. You're supposed to have less than a kezayis. The issue is like this. It's a little bit of a technical thing, but we're making a Adama together on this karpas. So this hadama we want to last all the way later until I get to maror. Why? Because when I'm going to eat the maror later, even though I've already made hamotzi, but it's very weird to just chomp down on a whole thing of lettuce or horseradish, even less so, in the middle of a meal, not in a salad and just like that. So really, that's type of thing that if you would eat that during a meal, you would have to make a hadama on it. You'd have to make a bracha on it. So therefore, the poskim say that the hadama that we're making way back by Karpas is really going to go working forward and work when we get to the maror also. And therefore, we should eat less than a kezayis of the Karpas, so that way we don't have to make a brei nefashos on the Karpas, because usually it's going to be more than a half hour until we get to the meal, which means that I'm going to lose the bracha achrona on the Karpas if I don't make a brei nefashos, right? Because I'm not going to, it's not going to be connected to the maror as far as the bracha achrona is concerned. Okay, I don't want to get sidetracked with this. Anyway, eat less than a kezayis of the Karpas. And that's it. Okay. Urchatz Karpas Yachatz. After that, we break the matzah in half. That's, you know, Yachatz. Then comes the mitzvah of Magid. Now, Magid is really the main mitzvah of the night. This is very important for people to realize. You know, sometimes something that people kind of skim through, you know, they're very tuned in for the kosos, and they're very tuned in for the matzah and the maror. When it comes to Magid, they're tuning out, they're doing something else. If it's women, they're working in the kitchen and moving pots around. So that's a very big no-no. You know, Magid is the main mitzvah of the night. I remember I heard once from Avigdor Lebensfeld, you know, that he said that, you know, this is the mitzvah d'oraisa of the night, is Magid. You have to tell your children and your grandchildren that's the mitzvah of the night, and everybody has to read along in the Haggadah. A person has to really be focused in. Now, the halacha is as follows. Again, like we just said before, everybody has the mitzvah to read the entire Haggadah through, that whole section of Magid. Men, women, everybody has that chiyuv. The way we can do it is through Shomei Ka'ona, that if I'm hearing somebody else who's saying it, so I can be Yotzi with them. Okay, but it's just very important that means that you have to be tuned in, you have to be following along. You know, the truth is, if you don't understand it in Hebrew, it's better to read it in English. When we have people at our table, you know, when we're reading the Haggadah, if we have somebody at our table that doesn't know what's happening in Hebrew, so usually we take turns reading, going around the table, and I'll tell that person that they should read along in English what we're reading in Hebrew, and when it comes to their turn, they read it in English, and we'll read along in Hebrew quietly. But you know, the idea is for you to understand what you're saying and to go through every word over there. Now again, Shomei Ka'ona works if the person who's saying it knows that they're saying it for everybody, and the person who's listening knows that they're listening from that person to be Yotzei, and you're hearing and tuned in for every word. You know, if a person is spaced out and not paying attention, they're not Yotzei Shomei Ka'ona. Also, if it's a child reading, you can't be Yotzei Shomei Ka'ona. If it's a boy under 13 or a girl under 12, you know, if you're going around the table reading, so for that section, you have to make sure to read yourself. You cannot be Yotzei with a kid reading Shomei Ka'ona, because they're not really chayim in the mitzvah. Anyway, Magid is very important that everybody tunes in for, not just for the songs, you know, but for the whole way through. That's like the main mitzvah of the night. Okay, when it comes to Mutzi Masa, now we have three mitzvahs that are coming up right now in succession that are going to happen. We have the mitzvah of Achilas Masa. It's a mitzvah d'oraisa, comes up once a year. Of all the mitzvahs of the night of Leil Pesach, there's only two mitzvahs that are mitzvahs d'oraisa. One of them, well, Kiddush is its own mitzvah d'oraisa, but that, you know, like I said, it's not connected to the Seder per se. That doesn't count. There's another two mitzvahs of the Seder. One is the mitzvah of Sipur Yetzias Mitzrayim, the mitzvah of Magid, and the other one is the mitzvah of Matzah. Matzah today is still mitzvah d'oraisa. All the other mitzvahs we have are d'rabbanan. Maror is only the d'rabbanan, you know, commemoration of when we'll have the Karban Pesach Mirtz Hashem. But Matzah is still in the Torah. So the halacha is, that's one mitzvah, is Achilas Matzah. The next mitzvah is Achilas Maror, where every person has to eat a kezayis of Maror. And then, Zeichel Mikdash Kehillel, there's a mitzvah for everybody to eat Matzah and Maror together to commemorate the way that Hillel used to eat the Karban Pesach, which was essentially a shawarma, right? We can't wait. You know, basically lamb in a lafa with lettuce, you know, what could be better? And that's what's going to be. Mirtz Hashem should be tomorrow night. Okay, now when it comes to each of these mitzvahs, there's different halachos, so I just want to go through what we're going to do. So first we're going to get up and we're going to wash the tefillah sedayim, this time with a bracha, right? That's, we're going to wash the tefillah sedayim. Then when we're going to go down to the back to the table to make hamotzi, so there's going to be two brachos we're making right now, and I'm really not allowed to speak from now until all the way after korech. Why? Because this bracha of hamotzi is, you know, that I do as soon as I eat the first bit of matzah. But the bracha of al achilas matzah, the bracha of on the mitzvah of eating the matzah, that's going to last all the way until after korech. So ideally, a person shouldn't speak until then. Now, the halacha is, after a person says these two brachos, every person has to eat a kezayis of matzah beheseva. Again, the men leaning, the women do like whatever their custom is. And this kezayis should be eaten b'kedei achilas pras, which again, because we're dealing here with the mitzvah d'oraisa, according to most poskim, is like, you know, 4 or 5 minutes, let's say. So a person should try to eat a kezayis of matzah in 4 or 5 minutes. Now, how much is a kezayis? So, you know, if you're talking about a square machine matzah where they're all uniform and they're all made the same, so the poskim say 2/3 of a machine matzah is a kezayis. If a person eats 2/3 of a machine matzah, which I think is pretty easy, it's like a couple of crackers to eat that in 4 minutes, that's the mitzvah of achilas matzah. If you're dealing with hand shmura, those big round hand shmuras, it gets very complicated and detailed because it depends if they're thick or they're thin. What I do is, you know, there's a book, this Kazayas book, and he goes through there.